the Stockwasa Middle School. And we worked together on our project as it unfolded. Changed quite a bit as we were in Cambodia and as we came home, but we're very excited to show you what's happening at the Stockwasa School and how we're moving forward.
Okay, so this will start with my story. First came the kids. Teaching art at the Stockwasa Middle School with these wonderful kids inspired me to want to learn more about the Khmer culture and traditions. Then came Yari Levan. I was lucky enough to meet Yari and take his classes in traditional Cambodian ceramics. I wanted to be able to pass these traditions on to my students. We had the honor of meeting a master artist and having a private art lesson in drawing a charm flower. He was Yari's professor at the Royal University of Phnom Penh. He designed the gates and painted the murals in the Royal Palace. We were invited to the home of a relative of Palache, Chia. The women there weave yards and yards of the most beautiful silk patterns from their hand-dyed silk threads in beautiful bright colors. These are some of the interesting art, the cultural traditional art forms that we saw in Cambodia. So we were introduced to shadow puppets. We learned about spirit houses, which were in many homes. The paintings that we saw were, we saw them in the homes, we saw them in the museums, and also in the schools. The wood carvings that we saw, and also the printmaking. We attended lessons and learned about how to do the monkey dances and other traditional Cambodian dances, and I was inspired to learn about how to make the monkey masks. We frequented a store in Cambodia called Friends, and what they did was they brought children in and had them make arts to sell to help the children of Cambodia. So I was interested in learning more about that. So I actually did some research into the recyclable items that they made and turned into jewelry, wallets, belts, and other items. Kampong Chaneng was the birthplace of pottery, and originally I was just going to just study pottery, but every day was such an amazing experience in learning about so many different types of arts that along with the traditional style of ceramics that I was going to teach to my children and to the other art teachers in Lowell, my curriculum was largely built way beyond ceramics.
And my story starts off the same as Lynn's. We are inspired by our students. I want to learn more about Khmer culture because of the inspiration that I get from my students and also the staff at the Stockwasa School. My most transformative experience in Cambodia was at the Cambridge Cambodia School. It was several days into our trip after we had met people that you might view in society as important people. And then I knew that I was home and that something was going to happen with this school because I was sort of with my own people in a way, the everyday people that just want to make the world a better place, but sort of nobody knows about them. So this is the lead teacher on the far right. This is Pala Ol. I've developed a sister school relationship with her. We speak by telephone every third Saturday. We work on our English. She asks me questions. We found out that we have much more in common than we expected in our day-to-day lives, our commitments to our own families, balancing work. And we're sort of sisters now in real life too. The photograph on the right is, on the left, are the students that are graduating from this school. This is a 7 through 9 school now. And the graduates need bicycles to attend high school. 25% of Cambodia's children continue on to high school, so this is an important vehicle, literally, for them to progress with their education system. Education was one of the rights that the Khmer Rouge took away, and it's beautiful to see it come back again and to be a part of where it's going now. There are 400 American-funded private schools in Cambodia, and this is just one of them. It was founded by the citizens of Cambridge, Massachusetts in 2008. We developed the partner school this fall. Several of us are on the board of the Cambridge Cambodia School. Our mission is to learn from one another, to promote cultural awareness, respect, and international friendship. Here are our students in the Lowell Garden. This is in the fall. We were fortunate enough to get funding a couple of years ago to create a garden in our school. And the first project that we are working on with the Cambridge Cambodia School was to fund a garden for them. The students had a penny drive, and you'll learn more about that later from Professor Hargis as where we're moving forward in terms of supporting the Cambridge Cambodia School. A little bit about the Stoklosa School. We are 96% poverty, and we are a very, very diverse school. We receive more than half of our students speak another language at home. We have well over maybe 16, 17 languages that are spoken in our school. We have refugees. Unfortunately, we have not received a refugee family in our school since the Trump administration has taken over our government. We miss them. They bring a lot of life and hope and resilience to our students and help us to remember what's important in life. So we hope that that will change soon as things settle down. We were supposed to receive 77 people from Syria recently, and they never came. But our students know about that, and we're going to move on. So here is our penny drive, what we did in the fall, and students that are helping just by their spare change. And the Lowell Garden is being realized in Cambodia. There's our sister school right there. The first thing they planted, we wanted to get the garden going. It's not a really great time of year to plant when it went in. There are morning glories growing there right now, according to Paula, who, as you know, I speak to. And here is Mrs. Barker with her students and our next steps besides the penny drive.
So, along with teaching art to my students so that they can take that traditional styles of Cambodian art, learn more about it and pass that on to their families. That was my main goal, was to keep the arts alive and Lowell in our kids, and all different cultures also. But for me to learn about the actual culture and how it's done right traditionally, right from Cambodia, was the most amazing experience. Because now I'm able to bring that connection to my kids, and it really makes it so much more real to have that experience. So along with using, we're fortunate enough to have a kiln in our school so we can make pottery. We can show the kids the traditional markings that are made on pottery, the traditional shapes of the vessels that are made in Cambodia. So we'll be making tiles with the chan flower on it, and really just getting the kids to talk more about it too. I'm finding out that children have pieces of art in their house that we will be making in class, and that really makes that connection between their grandparents actually and themselves. And so so along with my classes during the day, I also have an after-school program, and it's a Cambodian art program, and we're really trying to dive into as many different mediums that I experienced in Cambodia and show the kids how to make them. And this is, so the little girl on the right, she has a monkey mask, which I talked about earlier. So we actually have the kids making monkey masks, and they start out with the plastic. They used a mold from a couple of masks that I brought back from Cambodia. They make the plaster mask with it, and then from there they begin to paint it, and they can use where they can throw in their own colors and their own styles. They choose, you know, what color they would like to use, and then from there it goes into the detail and ends up to look exactly like the masks that we bought in Cambodia. And then through this experience, I have children in the class, like the little girl on the right, who was really excited, and more than that, to tell me that their grandparents have these masks in their homes, but they've been put away and they're hidden because they're valuable to them. And when we brought that experience to the kids, they went home and talked to their grandparents about it. And now, which is really exciting, the grandparents are taking the time to work with them and have them make them with them. So there's something that is happening that wasn't happening, you know, with our kids before, that I'm just so excited about. Another one of the things that we did was the recycling. I thought was a great thing, because let alone it's a piece of art, but what can we do in our country to help with recycling materials? And so in that store, I purchased a lot of jewelry and items that are made from recycled items. And this is an example here. This is a bracelet, and there's also necklaces that they sold. And they're basically made from paper clips and from like chip bags and all those types of like junk food items that are sold everywhere now in every country. And so what they do is they take them and they wrap them around the paper clips and they make beautiful jewelry with them. So our kids made this bracelet here. The kids at the Stoklosa made this bracelet. We've taken clay and we've made pendants from clay, and we've looked up different images of traditional Cambodian art, and the kids are inscribing them into the clay and then creating their own jewelry pieces with those pendants that they've made. Also, one of our students who moved here probably 2 years ago, I think, from Cambodia, she told me that she used to make this jewelry when she was in Cambodia, and she gave us instructions on how to make beads out of plastic bottles. So this is her necklace that she made, and she taught us how to do this. So I'm just really proud of the kids, and I think it excites them, and more kids are learning about it, and more kids are joining into the classes. Oh, these right here, what you see up here are also, the little girl on the left, that's a print that she made, so we're doing some printmaking. So she came up with that, you know, she did the Buddha, and what we're doing with those is, and all the kids down on the bottom, those are all their art that they made with printmaking. On the right, on the top, we have some watercolor paintings that the children made, and most of these kids, you can see, they're fifth graders that are in this. So, which is great also, because they'll keep coming back every year and doing more and more. But these are things that we saw in Cambodia. I took pictures of them, bought them in Cambodia, brought them back, and then showed them to the children, and that inspired their work.
The children have always been interested in Khmer dancing, and they have taught themselves from the blessing dance, and have done that in our school for a few years now. I am no dancer. I am of Scandinavian descent. I can't even move my hips correctly. So they're all self-taught. Many of them have taken dancing at the Angkor dance troupe, but this is from last year. It was sort of fun. They did the blessing dance for everyone, and then went outside. Of course, they usually would perform barefoot, and then they put on their like nice little American shoes and went off to recess. And I'm very proud of them. This girl is in the eighth grade, and she's been teaching this year. Now we're up to three dances. So The one on the right is a bamboo dance that they're learning. And again, I'm simply the body in the room, the grown-up that makes sure that the custodian doesn't shoo them out of the building. The UMass Lowell has donated the poles for us, and so we're going to do that, the coconut dance and the blessing dance, coming up within the next month or so. So there, I brought back from Cambodia the belts and the materials, and the children are going to be using that this year. Here is, I'm not sure if we can get this to play. We had sent this is a video. I'm sorry, my screen is gone. Oh, good. So this is, again, we want to establish friendship with our sister school. So this is just a little something that some students were doing at the park in Lowell, and we just sent it off to them. Fun for the American and the Cambodian cultures here to join together. And here is our partnership now extends to creating a business plan for to market some of the artwork that you just saw. I'm sure Professor Hargis will be talking about this, so I don't want to speak to it myself too much. But several of the artworks that you'll see, the individual artworks are going to be produced for our pop-up shop. And so we begin. This, I can't talk about this slide because I will lose my composure. But here we are with our students from afar and our students. That's my class at the courthouse in Boston. One story that I'd like to tell you is one thing, touching thing that happened of many at the sister school, the Cambridge Cambodia School, was Professor Yari asked the students what they'd like to be when we were there. And many of them said, I would like to be a teacher, I would like to be a policeman, I'd like to be a doctor, I'd like to be an engineer, and it was very beautiful. And then he said, would you like to be prime minister? And they laughed. And I was sorrowful that I didn't think that they could imagine themselves as growing into that position. And perhaps Professor Liven planted a seed that day. Who knows? Maybe a child from that school will be prime minister one day in Cambodia. But when the first day that Professor Hargis came to our school, one of the questions she asked was, what is a businessman? What is an entrepreneur? And the children talked to one another, and they came up with words. They said businessmen were important people, and that they had big tables. And the commonality that I saw hurt a little bit again, because I thought, I'm not sure that my students imagine that they can put themselves into that position and change the world. And so perhaps the seed has been planted in Cambodia for self-actualization, and again in Lowell for our marginalized students, that they will imagine that they could grow into anything that they conceive and work hard at. And I'll leave it at that for me.
That sums it up.
Yeah,
that sounds pretty good.
All set.